Welcome back to Salt City FC, the podcast about soccer in Utah and along the Wasatch Front, from Real Salt Lake to the Utah Royals to college soccer, even a little bit of high school soccer. We got into it last week. Shout out to our most recently announced and crowned state champions in the Utah High School Activities Association. But today we're going to go back to the NWSL. We're going to go back to Utah Royals FC for very special conversation with Utah Royals assistant coach and soon to be, I guess we'll call you, incoming head coach of DC Power Football Club, the launching soon USL Super League team in Washington, D.C. He's going back to the nation's capital, former DC United legend, both as a player and as a coach. Now, Utah Royals assistant coach legend. At least for a couple of days while he cleans some stuff up before he heads back to DC. Frédéric Brillant, Fred to his friends. I don't know if we know each other well enough to call you Fred, so I'll just call you Coach. Thank you so much for joining me here on this episode.
You can call me Fred. Thank you for having me. Thank you very much.
Well, I really appreciate it, Coach. I greatly appreciate it because you are a busy man right now, wanted by two different organizations, kind of double dipping a little bit as an outgoing assistant coach with Amy Rodriguez and the Royals, and heading over to DC Power Football Club in the USL Super League. So let's start right there with the new job. Just how did this kind of all come to be, and what excited you about this new Super League team in Washington, D.C., a place that you know very well?
Yeah, exactly. A place that I know very well. It was unexpected at all. You know, I was very pleased and very well here in the organization. Like I said, you know, previously, I really like Utah. It's a great club, great organization. But I received that offer, I will say a few weeks ago right now. And great opportunity for me, great step in my career. So it was very hard to say no. But in the same time, you know, I was a little bit between two chairs because of my situation with Utah. And then obviously we found an agreement with the club. They were very correct, great people, and they let me go, you know, and try to do my job over there. So I'm very pleased for that, and I'm very grateful for that.
Well, what was it exactly about DC Power, the ownership group, the Super League, and kind of what they had, what they're building over there in USL, that really attracted you about the job? Was it simply a matter of getting back to a city and a district that you know pretty well in Washington, D.C., or was there something about the club that you really liked too?
Yeah, it was not about the city, you know, because it was not like predictable. And the plan was to move my family here after school. So it was not the plan at all. But when the club called me, obviously, it's an easy move. I really like the city as well. I've been there since a few years already right now. So I know a lot of people over there, a lot of supporters, and they are very happy to see me back there. So it was an easy move, but it was not the plan, if I can say that.
Yeah, for sure. The best coaches in this world, they say, adapt their tactics to their personnel. And I think even if it wasn't the initial plan, you're adapting your tactics to your current personnel with DC, which is already the mark of a good coach. So you're well on your way. You've at least got that going for you some. Talk to me about the last couple of months, I guess, moving out to Utah, joining Amy Rodriguez's staff with the rebooted Royals, I like to call them Utah Royals 2.0 in a lot of ways, where you're relaunching a club from scratch, although there is a little bit of history there and maybe some crossover. But what have the last couple of months, I guess, been like as you've joined A-Rod and gotten to know these players and worked with them tactically and just gotten to know a bunch of people out here, both on a personal and a professional level?
So talking about unpredictable, it was not the plan for me either to join a women's team. You know, I was with men before, and my last job with DC was with men, you know, and with the MLS team. And then, when I had that situation with DC in the end of my contract, I received some call from different club in NWSL, and I was like, maybe it's the time for me to go with ladies, you know. And then I had a very good call with Amy, great person, by the way. She explained to me the project with Kelly, the GM, And I was very, very pleased. I was like, wow, it's a nice project, new club, new franchise, getting new players, try to implement a new way of play, and creating, a project together, like starting the journey together. It was very interesting, and I say, yeah, why not? So we had a few interview. The interview went well, and then we found the agreement. So, and then I'm here right now in Utah. So no, it was a good moment for me. It was also a challenge because I didn't know what to expect with ladies. But so far, I'm very pleased. Ladies are very different than men. Men, when you are doing a session, they don't mind, to understand why we do that type of session, and they don't want to see and understand the why behind each drill, or they just want to play. They just want to enjoy. And ladies, they are very involved in the process. They always want to know why we are doing this and what is the reason behind. And so I really like that way because as a coach, this is what you want to do, implement the way of play, but also teaching something, So when you talk with the players, with the women players, they get something when you talk with them. It's not like men, they just want to play, and it's different approach. And so far, I really, really enjoy it here.
It sounds like when you're coaching women versus coaching men, a lot of times, maybe when you're coaching the men, you explain the how, you explain the what, kind of what you want to do, what you're trying to do. But maybe there's a little bit less of, and I've noticed that, I think just even in my personal life, sometimes when you're working with women, you also need to really focus on the why. A lot of
Exactly.
times, why are you doing what
Totally.
you're doing?
Totally, yeah.
Yeah, why do you want to do? And I feel like that in a lot of ways maybe makes you a better coach, is you're not only thinking about what and how, but also why,
For
because you got
me,
to explain it, right?
yeah. For me, as a coach, as a young coach, it's perfect, because all the time I have to go deeper on my coaching. So I really like that, Even every single day, we have player who's coming to ask for meeting, individual meeting. Watching clips and understanding why we are doing that, why that position, and try to get better in that process. But yeah, no, so far I really like it.
You touched on it a little bit right there, but just to sort of maybe dive a little bit deeper, do you feel like you're a better coach over the last couple of months because of your time with Utah and in the NWSL?
Every single day I'm learning, I'm craving to learn from every tools that I can get. Coming here in Utah, it was also a challenge for me, but I took it like an experience for my future, and it went well. I learned a lot, the way ladies work, even the staff, we are working differently than the men that I was previously. So every single day is a new learning step, learning process. And yeah, so I will say that I'm getting better every single day.
Yeah, 100%. Well, and your neck. Oh,
Yeah,
sorry.
at least I get experience, and everything I get, better I am.
Yeah, absolutely. And I feel like even just watching you from our perch up there in the press box, I can see you getting a lot more active, a lot more involved. You've been a really good piece of A-Rod's staff here in Utah. I know she's sad to lose you, but also, I mean, you can't deny somebody the opportunity to be a head coach. So there's a little bit of that catch 22, right? You want to keep your assistants for as long as possible, but you've got to progress, go and progress and move on in your own career. And it feels like maybe we'll use that to kind of pivot to DC Power FC. This is an opportunity. It's obviously the next step. It's the chance to be a head coach, which you've been looking for in this new league. And for those who are unaware, maybe some Royals fans or NWSL fans, the USL Super League it'll be launching this August officially. You'll start playing games this August. It's a first division club. It's been sanctioned as a first division club by US Soccer already. There will be eight teams at the time of launch, including DC, but also New York, Charlotte, Lexington, Tampa, Fort Lauderdale, Dallas, and Spokane. And I know there's been a lot of talk online around the internet amongst supporters of professional soccer and US soccer in particular about kind of that first division, sort of a I'll use some air quotes here, another first division team, a competing first division league to the NWSL, and whether or not this country is big enough for two first division teams. I'm not entirely certain if the division sanctioning matters necessarily in this country, because we don't have things like promotion relegation where you know teams can kind of jostle back and forth. But I do want to get into kind of the startup nature of the Super League. Was that exciting to you? Did that kind of attract you, I guess, to sort of go to this league in DC?
Yeah, to be fair, you know, for me, is an opportunity for women to being part of a professional environment. You know, even player who didn't play with NWSL, they have another chance to play in the professional league, you know, first division league. So, and there is a lot of women who wants to play soccer in the country. There is I don't know how many players you can have in the country, but so it's another opportunity for them to play in one of the best division in the country. So, I think it's a good thing for everyone in the country, you know. I'm not sure it's a competition between NWSN and us because, you know, we are a brand new league. They are far, far from us, you know. They are doing an incredible job in NWSL. But, yeah, another opportunity for women to play soccer at the highest level.
I think maybe the biggest competition in a lot of ways, and I really liked how you explained that there. You'll maybe see it the most in Washington, D.C., because you guys, the Power, are going to be playing at Audi Field, which is the same place that you played at with D.C. United. Played and coached at there with DC United MLS. The Washington Spirit also play there. And there's also an XFL American football team. The DC Defenders have played there as well. Yeah. So there may be some competition, but it will literally be for pitch time and trying to schedule out that stadium. I feel for the grounds crew a little bit. I'm not going to lie. I'm a little bit scared for the grounds crew trying to schedule so many different events at Audi Field, but that's something for them to figure out and not for us. They're a lot smarter than we are, right, Coach?
Exactly, yeah. We have all role and responsibilities. They're going to do the job.
Exactly. As you start to transition over there to DC, and maybe I'll use this opportunity because I saw this floating online just the other day. You guys are going to be holding a closed door invite only professional player ID session beginning in just a few days, Monday, June 10th in Leesburg, Virginia. So you're already going to start identifying players and assembling your roster as best as you can.
I already started the process. You know, I'm watching clips and video, and I receive mail and call from agent, you know, because it's a long process, but I want also to get the right players. Is a key component for me to be successful, you know. There is a bunch of players, but I want the player who fit in the way I want to play, you know. And for me, it's crucial. So it takes time to do that. I spend hours and hours. I don't sleep too much right now, but it's very important for me to get the right players.
For sure. I don't want to get too specific into players and movement and that kind of thing, obviously, but can you give me kind of a general feel for what a Fred Brillant player or what a Fred Brillant team basically look like, kind of how you want to play?
But you can see that a little bit with Utah because, you know, I try to help and give some idea. I'm a coach who likes the ball. Every coach is going to say that, you know. We want the ball. We want to be position, team-based, whatever. But for me, it's the reality because, you know, most of the people, when you play at school, you didn't want to run behind the ball, right? So for me, it's the same when you play as a professional player. We want the ball. We want to dictate the game with the ball. And for me, the ball organizes, but also disorganizes the opponent. So having the ball for me is very important. It's a key principle in my system of play.
For sure. I liked what you said there. Every coach, it feels like, wants the ball. They want to play with the ball in a lot of ways. I think it's also important, and you brought this up a little bit tongue-in-cheek before, but it's also important to be able to adapt and to kind of know who you got. If you need to play direct at times, this Utah team, for example, has also been known to play direct at times. So it's also important to maybe not necessarily be locked into just one thing, but to be able to kind of attack in different areas, right?
Exactly. And it's not having the ball just to have the ball, you know. When you have the ball, what is the reason behind? You want to attract the opponent, or you just want to move the opponent, you want to create space somewhere, you know. I have a clear idea of why I want to do what I want to do with the ball, and hopefully my player will love that. So far, you know, all the talk I have with player, they love it, but now right now is the way you implement the system of play. Hopefully my player will get into it as quick as possible, and hopefully you're gonna see the way I want it to play.
Yeah, 100%. Very attacking oriented possession, but also possession with a purpose in a lot of ways.
Exactly,
former
because
RSL kid.
Yeah, if you want the ball, it's just for one goal, to score a goal. So having the ball in your defensive turn without purpose doesn't mean nothing, because you are more exposed, you know, because you are closer to your goal. So you have to get a purpose behind. What is the goal? Having the ball in your defensive turn, the goal is always to score. So I want the ball with the opportunity to score. We have the ball to create something in the final turn.
I really like that, and I looked up some of your numbers from your playing days, mostly in MLS. So you spent a lot of time in Belgium and overseas. You're originally from France, for those who can't tell by the accent. Your English, by the way, very, very good. We should have done this in French, to be totally honest, but you're killing it in English as well.
I'm working hard on it, you know. It's not the best, but when I arrived in US, I didn't speak English, and so far I'm very pleased with what I'm accomplishing right now. You know, I got a few soccer license. I'm doing a coaching right now, and yeah, I'm very pleased. I'm very pleased so far.
Yeah, well, during your playing days in MLS, in particular with DC United, and you spent some time with New York City FC. You were a defender, but you were also a pretty good goal scoring defender in a lot of ways. 55 goals in 99 appearances with DC United, a couple goals in just over 50 appearances with NYC, 27 goals over 16 years in your professional career. Do you feel like you can take, like you take kind of some of that from your playing days into almost that positionless football in some ways, where everybody can be dangerous in certain circumstances or certain scenarios on the field to be attacking?
Exactly. And my role was different, you know, when I was in France or Belgium or even with New York and DC, you know. When I was in Belgium in the beginning, it was just defending. And then if you have a chance to score on set pieces, it's fine. When I arrived, by example, with New York, no, we wanted to create opportunity with building from the back with Patrick Vieira. So I had a different role as well, but I had the chance to score in different way with all the club that I went, you know. So most of the good friends are gonna say to you that I scored goal with my best foot, which is my head.
You did have a lot of head goals.
Lot of joking, yeah, the joking friends, you know. So yeah, we laugh about that because yeah, most of the goal was with my head. But yeah, I scored a lot of important goal. I think I'm the only one who scored during the playoff at Roddy Field, if my memory is good and if nothing changed so far. But yeah, I try to be present in the moment, you know. I'm not a good loser, not at all. So yeah, I try to give my best. Everything I'm doing, I try to give my best.
For sure, for sure. Well, you've certainly given your best, again, even for a fairly short time for the last couple of months with the Utah Royals. And maybe I'll wrap it up a little bit on this. What's the kind of the main thing that you feel like you can take from your time with Utah Royals FC that you're going to go, this is something I'm always going to remember for your coaching career, or even maybe for your personal life or whatever it is? Like what's kind of the number one thing you're always going to remember from your time in Utah?
Like I said, great organization, great people. I really enjoy being here. I didn't have time to visit too much the city. Yeah, the club, amazing people, great organization. I really enjoy the time there. I will say also the relationship I had with the staff, with Amy, James and Maris. Was amazing, but also all the people around, medical staff and physios and also head of performance. I think we had a good group of people over there, so it was tough to tell them that I was leaving. But no, very good. But also the relationship with the player. We had a good relationship with player. Unfortunately, we didn't have the result, but like I said to them all the time, it's a process, you know. We have a young team. young players, rookie players also. We are building something in the long term, you know. But when you see the game that we played, most of the time we were the better team in terms of possession, in terms of creating chances. But we miss just the finishing part or silly mistakes sometimes when we concede goal. But it's a process, and I strongly believe that right now we are in the bottom of the league, but in the next couple of months or weeks, the team is gonna go up step by step.
For sure. Well, it is always a process, and I think it's important to know that process as you get into new teams, take over new clubs, even jumping into new leagues like you are right now with the USL Super League. And so the process just starts again, just with new colors and a new crest. And I got a feeling, Coach, I can't speak for everybody too perfectly, but I got a feeling you're going to have a lot of supporters here in the Beehive State in Utah for the DC Power. Are you okay with that?
Yeah, I'm totally fine with that. And, you know, I'm going to be a huge supporter of Utah Royal as well, and also the Salt Lake, because right now I follow them. So, yeah, you know, soccer is a small world. And if you can get a good relationship with people, at least, you know, people understand who you are, what you are doing. And I think it's the best way to just be yourself, you know. And when you are true and honest with people, people follow you and support you. So, yeah, hopefully they're going to support me as well over there.
Well, maybe I'll call up the RSL team store at America First Field. We'll get a little corner for DC Power FC merchandise. Just a couple items, just a little corner, not the whole thing, but just, you know, maybe some shirts, a hat or two, a scarf. We got to sell scarves, right?
You're right.
Yeah, just a few things. That's all. Like not too much, but I know some people. I'll make some calls. We'll try to get that worked out and figure it out, because again, new head coach Frédéric Brillant of DC Power Football Club, former Utah Royals assistant, now taking his first head coaching job in the USL Super League. Their season starts this August. It runs counter to the NWSL a little bit. It goes from spring or from fall to spring instead of spring to fall, with a little bit of a winter break in there, because places like Spokane and New York City also get really cold. DC gets really cold in the winter as well, as you know. So I'm sure there will be some breaks in there for the heaviest months, but spring to fall. So you can still support the NWSL and also support the USL Super League. And Utah Royals fans, you've already got a familiar face there in DC Power FC. Coach Fred Brillant, formerly of Utah Royals, now of DC Power. Thanks so much for joining me here on this edition of Salt City FC.
Thank you for having me. Always a pleasure.